But just so that you understand the structure of the morning, normally, typically what we do when we have a member highlight or member spotlight, what we will do is bring the member on, let them tell us a little bit more about who they are, open up a little bit more about their personality so that we get a little bit of a feeling of who the people are that are involved with the toolbox, who your fellow members are. Then I go through a series of pre-prepared questions. Now these questions, there are a list of 20 questions, and we allow Terry to select from the list at random. He won't answer all 20 questions, but we get him to select from the list at random. It just sort of helps to get a little bit deeper information from Terry. So Daniel's asking a question. Let me just have a look. Just had to go self-employed after losing my job. Question is, what is the most basic marketing way of finding work within a budget? Daniel, that could be quite an open-ended answer. There's a huge amount of things that you can do for free as far as marketing is concerned. Setting up your Google My Business or your Google Local Pages is key and important. Getting a website set up. Yeah, you can go and you can spend a fortune on a website, or you can set up a free one, but there are free ones available. Absolutely having a Facebook business page, completely different to your personal profile, but having a Facebook business page, that is completely free for you to do as well. And if you use it properly, it can be an extremely good form of marketing. Joining local Facebook groups, getting involved with other online free things like Nextdoor, and registering on those. Those are helpful as well. But if you're to ask me hands down, what's the best way to generate work as a, starting out first time in a local community, hands down, and it's not free, you've got to put some investment in, but it's still relatively low cost. It's got to be leaflet distribution. We teach what's called a leaflet domination campaign, which works extremely well for our members. But to do a proper basic leaflet campaign, hands down, gets you the quickest response. But like I said, there's a huge amount of free stuff that you could be doing and getting set up as you go self-employed or as you start out on your own as well. So hopefully that helps with that. Who was it that asked the question? Daniel. So hopefully that helps, Daniel. David has said, Daniel, join all the Facebook buy and sell groups, Nextdoor app too. Yeah, that's good. Jack Clark asking the numbers up here. I'm guessing that's for the evening. Not where we need them to be at the moment, Jack, but we will deal with that inside the member area between now and Monday. Trevor Mangan. Decided I don't want to work in catering again, 100-mile round trip each day. It was a rental property for a regular customer. It makes it hard to say no. I'm guessing that was a win, deciding not to do that. Look, I think, Trevor, you know my feelings in terms of traveling for the business that we do. Too many tradesmen, too many electricians specifically, end up traveling 60, 80, 100 miles a day to and from jobs. And all that time that you're in a vehicle, you are losing money. In effect, you're commuting, but you're losing money. And the reality is that in most cases, and I'll say most because there's obviously going to be the exception to the rule, but in most cases, between sort of 10 to 15 miles of where you actually live or operate should be plenty of work available to you if you're marketing yourself properly. Now, before everybody starts wailing at the computer, I know there are exceptions. I know there are sort of rural areas or 15 miles is probably the closest neighbor. I get that. But in the main, in most cases, 10 to 15 miles is plenty to actually generate a good income for a small service-based business. Chris Hector, win. His Kickstarter did the Facebook post, website, blog, GMB post every day this week. Excellent. Paid for MCS assessment for solar. Perfect. Getting panels and roof for the house. Nothing like a bit of pressure to get things implemented. Excellent stuff. For those of you who aren't aware, the Kickstarter thing, that is when you can have an individual working for you to help you with the marketing or the admin within your business. And I believe the government subsidize some of that as well. Just correct me if I'm wrong on that, Chris. But well done, mate. Excellent stuff. Gohan, Wynn signed up his first apprentice on Friday. Loving that. Excellent stuff. Nice to see other people benefiting from your successes. The employed strategies from your book. Excellent stuff. That's the book, The Sparks Blueprint to Marketing for Local Trades, which is available on Amazon if you'd like to purchase a paperback copy of it. Thanks for this, Gerhan. Or, in fact, you can actually get a free download copy by going to jdewan.com/free book. I think either Steve or Gary will type those links in for you. But excellent stuff. Well done, Gerhan. Protect my price and made dollars, whereas in the past I would have discounted to win a job. Excellent. Well, we know my feelings about discounting. But well done, Gerhan. Nice to hear it. Excellent stuff. Jack is saying you should join the toolbox. We would love to have you on board. We'll talk about that a little later on this morning at some point. Excellent stuff. Right. We have got Terry sitting out in the background. Keep your questions coming in. Keep your wins coming in. And we'll read them out as the morning progresses. But we're going to bring Terry in because this morning is about a member spotlight. And if you have any questions for Terry, please do type your questions in and we will read them out. So bringing Terry on, let's give him a big toolbox round of applause. That is, hit the thumbs up and the hearts button and just keep whacking that button while I say good morning to Terry. Oh, you look a bit unequal there. Let me equalize us a little bit. There we go. That's a bit better. And your mic is off. Right. Good morning, Terry. Nice to see you there.
Yeah, mate. You all right?
How's life with you?
Yeah. All right. Business has gone a bit slow, but I'll find a way around that.
Excellent stuff. All right. So let's kick off by, as I said, if you just tell everybody a little bit about who you are, don't just stop at the fact that, hi, I'm Terry, electrician from Medway, but tell us a little bit about who you are, what excites you, what lights you up, you know, married, single, kids, what brought you into the industry, how did you start out in the industry, what brought you to the toolbox? So yeah, okay. Over to you.
Yeah, okay, yeah. I'm Terry from Medway, electrician. Thanks. I sort of got pushed into the industry, really. I started a bit later than most other people. I was a bit of a bum when I was younger. Left school, didn't really want to do anything. My dad's a Sparks. He's a contracts manager for quite a large company. So it was, right, if you're not going to get off your ass and do something, you're coming to work with the Sparkies on site. So I went there with the idea of, well, I'll do it for a bit until I find something I want to do. But yeah, within my first week, I think it was, I thought, this is it. This is what I want to do. I love this. So my background is commercial, really. I was in commercial for years. I've done countless office blocks up Canary Wharf. I've done the Excel Centre, Savoy. I've done it all. I think I got a bit of an opportunity to work for myself. Taking a lot of work from the MOD. So I thought, okay, I'll do this. This is a good chance here. That turned out to be not what it was promised. And I was getting the odd little bit of work once a month, at which point I jacked my job in and I sat at home thinking, oh no, now what do I do? I had a choice. I could have gone back to my job. I spoke to my old boss. He said, you can come back whenever you want, mate. I thought, I don't want to. I want to work for myself. So lo and behold, I've done what everyone else does. I jumped on a checker trade. And yeah, I was a busy fool, as you would say. I was a very busy fool. I was working 7 days a week. The money was coming in, but it was going out a lot quicker. Then I went through a very difficult time in my life over the last couple of years. And I dropped the ball. I wouldn't turn up for jobs. I wouldn't answer my phone. I weren't interested. And I had no work at all, no money. And I thought, right, you got to do something. You've got to do something because you're past the point of about to go bust. You know, it's sort this out or go and work for someone. So yeah, I started looking for help to market my business and stumbled across the toolbox. It was a last ditch attempt, really. It was the final thing. If this don't work, I give up. And yeah, lo and behold, you saved the day, James. that's about it in a nutshell, really. That's where I am now.
As much as I like to hear that, and as much as I could sit here and talk about the toolbox all day long, let's not. I will come to the toolbox in a little while, and we'll explain to everybody else what it's all about. But in terms of who Terry is, so you went to work with a firm that your dad worked for.
Yeah.
It wasn't your dad's firm. It was a firm your dad worked for.
No, it was a contracts manager.
Okay. And what age were you?
About 20.
Right. Okay. So you wouldn't have been pushed through the typical apprenticeship route, would you, at that stage?
No. I basically went in as an electrician's mate, and very quickly realised that this is what I want to do. So I left that company actually and went and found a job with another firm. We were doing London City Airport on nights.
Right.
So then I could go there on nights as a mate, make myself free in the day, and one day a week I put myself through college. I'd done my own apprenticeship. So yeah, that was that.
Yeah, so not a traditional route. It's actually funny. It's funny as you're talking. I'm just clocking things up here as you're talking, because obviously you're only down the road from me here, where we are at the moment. But also, a couple of the things you're mentioning, we've worked in very similar locations, probably in different roles and different times, because the Excel Center, I've worked their security installation.
I've done the extension on it.
London City Airport, I worked on security installations there as well.
Really?
So there's a few, there's obviously a few things that I wasn't aware of in your background that are...
You were doing the City Airport? So I spent years on that job. In fact, the
I was
still there.
I was working with a company at that time called ICTS, and they were involved in all the biometrics and the card readers, the barriers, the camera systems.
Barriers that never worked, didn't you?
That was thank you. Thank you. Anyway, so getting back onto you. So we know about the work history. We know you've sort of entered, rather than the apprenticeship route, you came in through the adult learning route into the industry. You've obviously decided it's where you want to stay. It's where you enjoy being and you like it. So what else do you like? What do you do outside of work?
Outside of work, fishing. I'm massive on my fishing. Bit of carp angling. Go to France to do that once a year for a week. If I'm not doing that, then I'm with my kids.
Okay, cool. What's the long term plan for the business?
I mean, if we're saying sky's the limit, I would love to get to a point where I can have a few people working for me. I'd love to get to a stage where I can put the tools down and concentrate on marketing and other things like that. That's the ultimate goal, yeah.
Okay, and you suggested, and you don't have to answer this next question at all, it's your life and your privacy, but you suggested that you've gone through a bit of a rough patch.
My wife left me, which was fine. After leaving me, she turned very nasty. She removed my kids. She moved away with them, wouldn't tell me where they were. I couldn't find them, I couldn't see them, I couldn't speak to them on the phone. I had to get the police to try and find them. It went on for a while. I was manically depressed, started to move with my sister, I couldn't be left alone. But I eventually found them. I found out they were in Bognor Regis, and I went down to Bognor Regis one morning. I got there at 6 a.m, and I literally drove all day, road after road after road after road, checking every house, looking for a girl. Eventually, I came across a house, and there was a car on the drive, and I thought, that's where my kids are then. And that thing, it's a plan. I knocked on the door, you're not seeing them, slammed the door. That's the end of that. I've driven all day looking for your car. yeah, I took it to court in the end. It's now put me in about 40 grand worth of debt doing that. But they're my girls, and I'll be living on the streets before I give up on them. So we did that, and I got there in the end. I've now got more custody than I ever asked for. The sky's the limit. I can see them whenever I want, and it's been worth it. It's been worth it, yeah.
Excellent. But obviously, as a result of that, the business took a back seat.
Massive. It was non-existent. I wasn't going to work. It was non-existent. I was ignoring phone calls. I hold my hands up. It's completely wrong. But I actually ignored customers. I was halfway through their job, and I just walked away. I couldn't give a shit, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to have a huge impact on your mindset when, you know, it's, but when something that big happens and you've got to put that amount of effort into resolving it and getting it sorted, business does take a back seat. Everything takes a back seat, doesn't it?
At the end of the day, you work, your business, your income, it's very important. It ain't as important as your family, is it? So
no. Family's got to come first. So you obviously, you've resolved the situation, you're happy with, well, as happy as you can be with how that situation has resolved itself. And then you found the toolbox in November, I think. Well, you came and joined us in November. What was the build up? What was the build up to finding the toolbox or discovering that we even existed?
Like I said, I turned my back on everything and created so much debt through solicitors and barristers and all the rest of it. I was going bust. I wasn't paying my mortgage, nothing. And I just sat down one night and thought, you need to sort this out. It was, you know, the courts and all that had finished. I'd got my kids and reality had hit that how bad things had got around me. And it was, you need to sort this out. The thing with Checker Trades, which is what I was on, is about reviews. You've got to keep getting reviews to start at the top of the list, and then people call you. Where I'd let things go, I drop down the list. Phone's not ringing. You can't get reviews. You can't get back up the list. Vicious circle. So I thought, you need help. You need someone who's been here and done it and to guide you through a process to from the bottom up, basically. So I started Googling business mentors, marketing mentors, the marketing teachers, things like that. I think I told you before, actually, James, I actually stumbled across another one first, and I was very much considering joining that one. But whilst I was Googling that one to find out reviews on it, because I was very unsure about it. There was something about it that just weren't sitting right with me. I was doing a lot of Googling on that business and the person that runs that business and reading a lot of reviews. It was very hard to find anything. And in the process of that, I just stumbled. I don't know if it was Facebook, Google or what, but I just stumbled across you. I won't lie, I was broke. That night I rang you and paid my first month's membership. That was my last bit of money. That was it. That was the last 100 quid out of my pocket. And I thought, you've got to throw the dice on this. You've got to trust this guy. You don't know him from Adam. It could be full of shit. You could have been a con artist, James. I thought, at the end of the day, it's 100 quid. That 100 quid ain't getting you far, so you might as well go for it. And yeah, I did, yeah. Yeah, I done it.
I think the interesting thing that when you talk about the lead generation organizations like the Checker Trades and that, is that when you don't have the cash available and when you stop paying them, then everything sort of comes to a stop. You don't get those leads. The leads don't come in.
Yes.
Whereas when you build your own strategies, which is what we teach, when you build your own strategies and you're not dependent on people like that, then you can sort of turn the tap on and off as and when you wish. And you're building assets. You're building assets that will keep returning you at least inquiries. I mean, it's then up to you to change those inquiries into business. But at least you're building marketing assets that will return you inquiries on a regular basis.
Yeah. I actually got to the point where I was working for. I just started taking the odd bit of work off of the insurance company that owns Checker Trade, and I thought, this geezer's making money out of me left, right, and centre here. It was I was doing both of them, and I thought, and they're both as rubbish as each other, if I'm honest.
Right.
So, yeah, it was time to make a change.
Cool. So what's your experience been so far then?
Brilliant. I started off with the leaflets, as I'm sure everyone else did. They work, obviously. Lately, it's gone a bit down. Do you know what? I've been a bit slow with it all. As I said a minute ago, you know, I joined this just after I finished going through courts and that. So literally a week before joining you, I just moved into here. So I've been trying to sort that out, get settled, get the kids settled. So I was a bit slow with it all. I had most of my eggs in the basket of the leaflets.
Right, okay.
Weather took a turn for the worse and you can't get anyone out. So, yeah, I'm not that far with the toolbox. So I've got the website. That's now looking brilliant, thanks to Gary. I don't know if he's on, but yeah. But yeah, the toolbox is great, really, isn't it? You get so much help. The Facebook group is the best bit about it, hands down. The lads in there are unbelievable.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we'll come back to talking about that again in a few minutes. Right now, what we normally do, I think you're aware of the setup, so just to explain for everybody else, I'll come to Chris's comment in a second, but the normal setup here is I've got a list of 20 questions. They're all preset. Everybody gets the same list of 20, but we'll probably ask you about five or six of the questions. We'll let you pick those at random yourself. So you pick from one to anywhere between 1 and 20, and I'll read out the question, and hopefully you will answer them to the fullest of your ability. And then we'll open up the floor to any of the people on here who would like to ask you a question about you, your business, the background, how you've overcome certain things, whatever they'd like to ask, as long as you're happy to answer it. Before we go to those questions, though, I just want to see, because we've got a comment from Jack, Chris, and Gurhan. So let's have a look. Jack, if the socials are no go, are we going down to Shosner? That's a big possibility, my friend. Something will have to happen. Something will have to give. Chris Hector, politicians convince us that when things go wrong, the state will look after us. It's such a lie. Terry's story proves the best person to improve your lot is yourself. Absolutely right, Chris. I have an expression or a saying that I use, and I say it quite often. The members in the toolbox will have heard it, and it's a statement that I use quite often. It's just simply, if it's got to be, it's up to me. And in simple terms, I'm responsible for anything that happens in my life. If I want to make something happen or change something, then I make it happen. And you're quite right, Chris, in your observation with Terry and his situation. You know, it's by acting himself that things change. It's by, you know, you're not going to have, well, the state will look after things to a certain degree, to a certain extent. But the bottom line is, the best person to look after you is yourself. The best person to take care of you and yours is yourself. And without depending on anybody, you can't, you know, if you're depending on anybody else, they can remove that support and remove that help at any time. But when you become self-sufficient, when you become able to look after things yourself and do things for yourself, it's just, you're in control. Gurhan, most definitely, by nature, I believe most people are creatures of circumstance, but it's up to ourselves to change our look. Absolutely. Excellent. Right. Terry, let me just flash up on screen so that people can see that these questions do exist. You can turn your headset because you're not going to get to see what questions are coming up. So that is the list of questions. There's 20 questions on the list. Just flicking them up there. And Terry's going to select a number.
Number 10.
What's your most memorable customer and why?
Do you know what? My most memorable customer will be my first customer. And because I made such a palaver out of it. Okay, like I said, I went on my own to take work off the MLD. So it was my first customer, because I've done a couple of little jobs for them, but my first actual person that, anyway, he rang me up and very excited. He said, I've got a light switch in my bedroom. The door's whacked it and it's smashed down the middle. Can you replace it? Of course I can. When can I come around and take a look? He lived in Gillingham. He wanted a light switch changing. And I got in my van and I drove around and I looked at a light switch. It had already told me to smash. And I said, yeah, I can change that. I'll book you in for tomorrow. I'll be back. And I went home. Then went back the next day with a light switch and changed it. And I got home again and I thought, you made a right meal out of that one. You've been to his house twice. He told you what the problem was on the phone. You just said, yeah, I'll be around later. I'll change it for you. It's this much. So that's one I'll never forget. Never.
You're not alone. You're not alone in that. People do that over and over and over again. I mean, you'll get.
I think about that guy all the time because he's actually. I've never seen him since that day. And obviously, since doing the toolbox, we do ideal. He is my ideal customer to the team. Mr. Mortimer, his name was, a retired teacher. And when I look at my ideal customer, every time I think, that's Mr. Mortimer. That is him. He's the person. Most memorable customers definitely Mr. Mortimer.
But you look at a very simple situation like that. How many other people, and I bet you there's people on this call as well, how many other people have had calls like, oh, I just bought a light fitting from B&Q. Can you come around and fit it? And some people will go, oh, yeah, when can I come and have a look? And they'll do exactly that when, you know, all you have to do is, right, you got the light fitting. You're obviously replacing light for like, I'll be around and I'll do it. Job done. Minimum charge. And away you go.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, 99% of my jobs now, I know it's not the most professional way to do it, but I quote them over the phone or first inquiry and I book them in there and then.
Yep.
Saves. So easy.
Saves a lot of time and a lot of money.
Yes. Yeah.
Excellent. Next question. Number?
Number 17.
Number 17. What has been your least successful marketing campaign or strategy?
Ever.
Ever.
I genuinely don't know. Least successful marketing campaign. I've got to say there hasn't been one because I never really advertised before joining the toolbox. I don't think I've tried with you has worked. Before the toolbox.
Anything you were doing?
We'd have to say check a trade, wouldn't we? We'd have to say check a trade because it is, I'm paying someone to find, you know, you're paying for work. That's all I can say really on that one, James.
Okay. I mean, I have to say in the interest of balance, yeah. I'm not a fan of check and trade, but some people do get good results from it, you know.
Well, yeah, you will. If you do it the way they want you to do it, you will get results, but they're the type of customers that don't want to pay much at all. Also my van. I paid about £500 to have my van sign written and I don't have one phone call for that.
Yeah, well, vehicle signage isn't. I mean, the best calls you get from vehicle signage is, "Have you got any jobs going? Have you got a start?" that tends to be the best offer vehicle signage. But again, you know, there are ways. So before the toolbox, did you ever try any leafleting or anything like that beforehand?
No.
No.
Okay. No. Purely check a trade, word of mouth, and of course, I had the odd little bit from the MOD on the barracks.
Yeah, because quite often when people start out, they try a leaflet campaign and they find that it doesn't work or it fails for various reasons.
A few people mentioned it to me and I always had the attitude of, no, I'm not doing leaflets, they won't work.
Well, yeah, and most people have that kind of success with them or lack of. Well, yeah, there's a way and when it's done properly, it works absolutely gangbusters. But the other thing that people say that they try as well is they reckon they try Facebook and they get nothing from Facebook. And again,
So I always had a Facebook business page I don't know if I'd heard it somewhere before or I just knew it, but I always knew that posting endless pictures of your work wasn't going to do the job. So I had the page, but I knew what wouldn't work, but didn't know what would work. So I just never done anything on the page. Just didn't bother.
Yeah, and most people are the same. Most people, they set up a Facebook page and then don't make it work for them, and then they'll say, well, Facebook doesn't work. But it does work when it's done properly. But yeah, we quite often get a huge amount of examples of the stuff that don't work. Okay, so next question. And by the way, guys, while he's thinking of this, if you have any questions for Terry, please do make sure you pop them in. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, number one.
Number one. What's the hardest thing you've ever had to do as a Sparks?
As a Sparks?
Yeah, what's the hardest thing you've ever had to do as an electrician?
What do you mean? The hardest thing I've ever had to do was when I gave up my job to take on all this work, as I said, and I found myself sat at home with nothing after being lied to. And everyone was saying, go back. Craig was my boss's name. Everyone was saying, go back to Craig. Craig will take you back. Go back. You know, you're earning decent money. And I had to make the decision that I don't want to work for someone. So yeah, the hardest thing I had to do really was decide.
Okay. So what about work wise? What about work or job wise? I mean, for me, it was in the latter stages of my apprenticeship when we actually went and we rewired a pig farm, and that included all of the freaking troughs where basically where the pigs were living, and it stank. And every single day, every day we were there, we had white coveralls on and we had to get rid of them and burn them. And it just, the stink was in your nose for days afterwards. But that, for me, that was the hardest, the worst kind of thing I ever had to do as a Sparks.
The worst one I've had, I was doing AMPR cameras for Sainsbury's on nights. In the winter, pulling armors through a car park in the pissing rain. And there was no, oh, we're raining off. There's like, you're not raining off, you're getting this done. He was like, I was soaked through. Like, I remember one night, literally laying on the floor, trying to make this armored off underneath this little thing. And I looked and I thought, you're laying in snow, Terry. It's 2 o'clock in the morning, you're laying in snow. What the are you doing? And the money weren't even that good. Yeah. And I finished that night and I thought, yeah, I'm not doing this anymore. This is ridiculous. That's the worst job I've ever had.
Gerhan is saying, fuck that. I think that's in reference to the pig factory. So I'll ask everybody that's watching out there at the moment, what's been your worst? What's been the hardest thing you've ever had to do in your job as a Sparks? Or some of you are heating engineers, some of you are plumbers. But what's the hardest thing you've had to actually do as far as your job is concerned? We'll let them type that in while you're asking the next question.
Next question. Number six.
What's the most interesting thing that you have found in a customer's property, either under the floorboards or in a cupboard or in a loft? And I mean a cupboard that you're supposed to be in.
I found a gun. We came across a gun with my apprentice at the time. I don't have a apprentice now, but the lad I had with me at the time, he came across a gun in a loft underneath the boards. That was quite alarming, really. I was like, we just left it and didn't see that sort of thing. Countless sex toys, actually, under floorboards and whatnot. That's it. Probably the most interesting thing was the gun.
I'm guessing you didn't tell the customer about the gun, so you don't know if they were aware of it, if it was left there from previous.
I didn't want to bring it up. I don't know who I'm dealing with here. I just left it. I thought, I'm not getting involved. I'm not getting involved. I'm sure it wasn't a murder weapon or anything like that. The guy probably didn't even know it was there. I thought, I'm not, just leave it. Don't do us.
Yeah, it is interesting, the range of stuff that people do come across. Anything from, as you say, sex toys to, well, money, everything, all sorts of. I think there was one loft in particular in a building in Croydon where we came across, and the chap had died, and the daughter was clearing out and sorting out the house and doing whatever. But we were called in, I think it was an extractor fan issue, whatever it was, got into the loft, and it was like a bag of cash. Like a huge bag of cash. But the thing is, a lot of the notes were older denomination notes. So whether she was able to get them, whether she was able to get them changed up, or, you know, get them back to, I'm guessing she was, if you take them to a bank. But there was like notes that had been out of date. There was other ones that were in currency, in date, but there was loads of them that were like out of date as well.
Yeah, we came across two carrier bags of money once. It was Chinese money. Again, I just ignored it. I'm not mentioning it. Just leave it. Don't do it, mate.
Interesting stuff. Julian saying, thanks, Terry, for sharing your story. Excellent. So next question, sir. We'll do two more of these, and then we'll open the floor to the guys, and then we'll wrap it up.
We'll go with number 20, shall we?
Number 20. That's a simple one. What's your favourite movie and why?
Shawshank Redemption. I don't know, I just love it. I can watch it over and over and over again.
Yeah? What is it about it that's appealing to you?
I think it's just the story behind the guy, isn't it? You know, throughout the whole film, he's not done anything wrong and his life's been ruined. But he weren't going to allow it, and eventually he found a way to sort that. He found his way out, didn't he? But yeah, hands down, best film in the world. That I love it.
Excellent, cool. Next,
number three,
guys. We're going to make this the last question for Terry. So if you guys have any questions for him at all, jump in and ask. Again, another nice, simple one here. Want a good, deep explanation on this then. What's your favourite tool and why?
It's got to be your knife and fork, isn't it? Your terminal and your cutters. Why? Because they're always there and they do anything. But you can do anything better than cutters and terminal. So yeah, my terminals and cutter, I'd say. Or my skill saw. I like my skill saw. You know what? For lifting floorboards, I was one that was so unprepared for it, and I used to make such a meal out of it. You know, like, I used my multi-tool, I'd always have to find a bit that had already been cut. And then one day I thought, this is bollocks. I just went down Screwfix, bought a skill saw. And since then, makes your life so much easier. Or a you know, for chasing your boxes out, what they call them, they come with the square bits on them.
The routers.
Yeah. I bought one of them in January, actually. And that has saved me so much time. Yeah, a few there, half me toolkit there, basically.
So if I said coat hanger to you, what would it mean?
Coat hanger,
yeah,
fishing cables.
there's a whole generation of Sparks that wouldn't have a clue what I was talking about there, because now got their fiber rods and all of that. There was a time where your van wouldn't go without a coat hanger. Yeah, definitely.
I'm more about I've got a long range, James.
Yeah,
I'll get that cable eventually.
Excellent. Right, let's see. Has anybody else got any questions for Terry? Anybody at all? Jump in now. Ask any questions that you have. Steve Oakey said, old school Sparks, coat hanger is the best. Yeah, absolutely. Gohan's saying he's always buying coat hangers. Somebody coming up as Facebook user saying that they've always got a couple of coat hangers on board. Not sure who that is, and unfortunately, because we are on three different platforms, I can't tell. I can't go back over the phone and have a look and see who that was. David, can have trunking lid. Yeah, that was another one. Trunking lid with a bit of a screw on top of it or a coat hanger taped onto the top of it. That was another one. Bit of MMT too. Push it up the cavity. Good Lord. Still, no questions coming in, Terry. So what I'm going to do, mate, is I'm going to say thank you very much for your time. I want to thank everybody for attending. And just before we let Terry off the hook and let him go, for those of you who are not Toolbox members, by the way, if you're not a Toolbox member, just hashtag not yet in the comment section. Hashtag not yet. Because I just want to remind everybody who is not yet a Toolbox member that we are a community of electricians who are set on building our businesses locally. So it's all about local marketing and business development, developing your business for a local community. 90% of all Toolbox members increase their prices within the first month of being a member of the Toolbox. They go from not being in profit to being profitable. We work on a process of minimum charging. There is within the Toolbox over 500 training videos that are available to you to use. You're not just left to your own devices. As Terry's already said, there's a great community of guys who help and support you in your learning. And then you've got myself and the admin team who are there to help and support you in your learning as well. We have regular live presentations like these, but we have within our member area on a Monday evening, we have our member Q&A session, and we have our Wednesday training session. We do an hour's training on at least one component of the Toolbox system every single week. It is a system that we operate to. It's a six-step system called the S.P.A.R.K.S Blueprint. Information on that is available inside of the book, but we follow that because my belief is that if you follow those six steps, if you follow those six areas of your business and pay attention to them, you will have a successful business. So if you're not yet a member, I invite you to consider it and become a member of the community. There is a small monthly charge of £97 that's inclusive of VAT. And you get access to all of the stuff that I've just mentioned and so much more. If you want to have a look at it and find out more information about it, go to www.jdewan.com/toolbox. That's jdewan.com/toolbox. I'm sure one of the admin team will type the link in there. We would love to welcome you into the community. And I can tell you, number one, as Terry said earlier, he didn't know me from Adam. He thought I could have been anybody, could have been a con, could have been a ripoff merchant. And I could have been, but I'm not. I've been doing this now for coming up on 8 years now, helping other electricians to grow and develop their business. We have an ever-growing community of electricians who are seeing success at various different levels within their business. Nobody's going to promise you the sun, moon, and stars. Nobody's going to promise you that every single thing you do is going to work, but we will promise you that we will do what we can to help you to grow and develop your business. There is a 100% money-back guarantee. If you try it for the first month and you decide not for you, then all you've got to do is email me and say, James, I tried it, didn't like it, can I have my money back? And you get your money back. No arguments, no quibbles. I may ask a question or two just to help me to improve things, but nobody's going to hold a gun to your head or force you to stay. And there's no long-term commitment in terms of you're not tied in for 12 months or 24 months or anything stupid like that. You join if you like it, you stick around for as long as you like it. And when you think you've had enough, you can leave. I will say that a majority of the guys stick around for years. We have members in the Toolbox who've been in here now for 7 years and more. And you don't do that unless you're getting value from it. So I'd ask you to consider membership of the Toolbox if you're not yet a member. And we've got Craig saying not yet, David saying not yet, Gerhan saying not yet. Hopefully next time we talk, you guys will be on the list of absolutely our Toolbox members. So with that said, Terry, thank you very much for your time. Have you got any parting words that you'd like to say to the guys?
Only to anyone that's listening that isn't a member of the Toolbox. Like, I took ages to decide to do it. Read James's book honestly, the book is brilliant, and I can guarantee you won't regret joining. You really won't. That's pretty much all anything really. Yeah.
Excellent stuff, Terry. Let's see some toolbox round of applause for Terry. So smash on that. I'm just doing it now. The thumbs up and the hearts, just keep smashing on that. And we say, Terry, thank you very much. And I will catch up with you later. Take it easy, mate.